Good evening. Welcome to the September 11th Clifton Park Town Board meeting. Please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, Pat, if you would call the roll.
Councilman Whalen.
Here.
Councilman Standorn.
Here.
Councilman Ramon.
Here.
Councilman Walwood.
Here.
Supervisor Brown.
Here. There are no minutes. Communications and announcements. Just want to thank everybody that helped out with Hazardous Waste Day. We had over 550 cars come through the system, and it was very efficiently run. We had volunteers from CERT. We had the town clerk, of course.
And the town council.
Oh, yeah, I'm just going to get to him later. Mr. Romano, oh, here they are. Ms. Wallowitt and the town clerk and Mrs. Standart, and we had CERT folks and highway department, ECC volunteers. Thank you, team, for doing a great job and making sure that everybody not only had all their hazardous waste collected, but it was done efficiently. And if you've never been there, people get in and out. You don't get out of your car, and you're in and out of there in 5 minutes. So very efficient. So thank you again to everybody. This weekend coming up, we have Farm Fest. There's a very detailed brochure on the town website and Facebook page. So it'll list all the events coming up on Saturday and Sunday. We'll also have Red Cross volunteers that will be stationed on at least Sunday, right, Matt?
Correct.
I don't think we heard back on Saturday, but at least for Sunday, we'll have volunteers at Riverview Orchards collecting donations. So if you are down that way or have the opportunity, please donate if you can. I know a lot of people don't like to donate online. Some don't like to send in checks. They much rather hand a check or some cash to a Red Cross volunteer that's standing right in front of them. So we do want to offer that opportunity. Any other communications or announcements? Yes,
yes.
Mrs. Standart.
Thank you. We are entering into our fourth year of Youth Corps. And right now we're in the recruitment phase, interspersed with some of our hearings. And we have a Youth Corps informational meeting on this Wednesday, September 13th, for any students or residents of Clifton Park who are in 7th through 12th grade who are interested in joining the Clifton Park Youth Corps. Come to the meeting at 7 o'clock in the High School East Auditorium and learn all about this great program. And if you can't make the meeting, that's fine. Just go to clifftonpark.org, search for Youth Corps, and there's information there on how to get to join and how to get more information. So, looking forward to that.
Yeah, very good. Thank you. And fourth year of Youth Corps now, and it's been a tremendous program, and will be for many years to come, I'm sure. So thank you for your work on that. Any other communications or announcements? Yes, Ms. Waller.
As part of the Farm Fest event this weekend, Animal Control Officer Terry Cook and I are sponsoring a pet event. The pet event will have the Saratoga County Animal Shelter and pet rescue groups who have lots of dogs, puppies, kittens, and cats, lots of kittens available. There'll be pet vendors, groomers, daycare providers. A microchip clinic, our semi-annual microchip clinic will be there, $20 to get your pet microchip. There'll be demonstrations and information on microchipping and rabies and ticks. There'll be the Sheriff K-9 will be there and be doing a demonstration. It's from 10 to 2 at Riverview Orchards as part of the event. So while you're there, you can stop in and see Isabel, pick some apples, have some apple cider donuts, and maybe bring home a kitten. So thank you. Thank you, Phil.
Very good. Bring home a new member of the family. Why not? All right?
Yeah.
Anyone else? Very good. So we'll get right to our agenda tonight. First we'll be recognizing Denise Donald. And we do have a resolution in her honor. Pat, if you could read that, please.
This is resolution number 226 of 2017, a resolution recognizing Colonel Denise M. Donald on her appointment as Commander, 105th Airlift Wing, Stuart Air National Guard Base. Whereas Colonel Denise M. Donald was born into a military family, her father a Navy doctor, and her mother a nurse, and whereas Colonel Donald was raised with a sense of pride and desire to serve her country, and whereas Colonel Donald participated in the Naval Reserve Officer Training Corps program while earning a Bachelor of Science degree in Foreign Service from Georgetown University, and whereas during her sophomore year at Georgetown University, Colonel Donald began to consider flying as a vocation, and whereas upon graduation from Georgetown University in 1993, Colonel Donald was commissioned as an ensign through the Naval ROTC program and assigned to Naval Flight Training at NAS Corpus Christi, Texas. And whereas Colonel Donald spent 9 years in the United States Navy as a naval aviator, including a deployment in the Persian Gulf, and whereas following her service with the United States Navy, Colonel Donald joined the Air National Guard at Stuart Air National Guard Base in 2002 as a C-5 aircraft commander and pilot scheduler with the 137th Airlift Squadron. And whereas during her first tour at Stuart Air National Guard Base, Colonel Donald was selected in October 2005 to become the 105th Aircraft Maintenance Squadron Commander, earning her maintenance badge while continuing to fly as a C-5 aircraft commander. And whereas in May 2010, Colonel Donald assumed command of the 105th Maintenance Squadron, leading the unit through a conversion from C-5 to C-17 aircraft, while simultaneously qualifying as a C-17 pilot. And whereas after our transfer to the 109th Airlift Wing at Stratton Air National Guard Base in 2013, Colonel Donald commanded the 109th Maintenance Group while qualifying as a C-130 pilot. And whereas in May 2016, Colonel Donald was reassigned to the 105th Airlift Wing as Vice Commander. And whereas Colonel Donald has a command pilot rating with more than 3,800 hours flown amongst 7 different military aircraft. And whereas in August 2017, Colonel Denise M. Donald became the commander of the 105th Airlift Wing at Stuart Air National Guard Base, where she is overseeing over 1,330 personnel with an annual payroll of $78 million, creating a local area economic impact on over $150 million. And whereas Colonel Donald is the first woman to take on the role as a commander, and whereas Colonel Donald is not only a leader but a trailblazer and role model for the young women and young men in the military, and whereas Colonel Donald's command is even now flying resources and personnel to hurricane-stricken areas in the Caribbean, and whereas Colonel Donald's dedication to her country while using her time and energy on behalf of her community in a career that is far from over should be recognized, now therefore be resolved that Supervisor Barrett and the entire town board of the town of Cooper Park, New York, do hereby congratulate and salute Colonel Denise M. Donald on her appointment as Commander, 105th Airlift Wing, Stuart Air National Guard Base, and we are honored to have her as a member of our community.
I will move that we approve the resolution with a second by the entire board.
Councilman Whelan?
Yes.
Councilman Standart?
Yes.
Councilman Romano?
Yes.
Councilman Wallace?
Yes.
Supervisor Barrett?
Yes. Colonel, welcome. If you could, come up to the podium.
So thank you. It's a tremendous honor to be recognized this way. Of course, I'm only one of a lot of airmen and soldiers who are out there helping our community, our state, our nation. As I speak, we have 5 T-17 aircraft on the road. We've helped in Texas. We're helping in Mississippi, in Florida, and St. Thomas. St. Thomas is not the St. Thomas that it was a couple days ago. Mm. So we are integrating very well with the 106 Rescue Wing, which is open on Long Island. So it truly is a Team New York effort. Our work is far from over. As you well know, Irma is now really just passing through, and Hurricane Jose is on its way. So we are helping as we can while still doing things overseas. We have a C-17 in Africa right now, and we have one in Greenland.
And that was one of the questions I wanted to ask you. For people that aren't familiar with how the operation works, how has what's happened recently with the hurricanes. How has that affected your day-to-day mission?
Well, it has impacted our day-to-day mission slightly. Tomorrow I was supposed to go to Greenland, and that has been pushed by 48 hours because all of our planes, we have 7 aircraft on station right now that are ready to go, they're all deployed doing things. So there has been slight impact. However, like I said, we're still supporting overseas missions and at the same time doing things like our family day yesterday. So we had a chance to spend a little time with our family with bouncy castles and sun and some pretty good food. And so I have 2 very exhausted children.
Oh!
My work here is done.
They look good, though.
A full, full donation to the community.
Now, as your career progressed, you are now the first woman to attain this position as wing commander. I mean that's phenomenal for anybody, but to be the first person to do something is just tremendous. And we're very proud of you and your service, and we just wanted to salute you and thank you for your service very much. Again, for folks that might not be familiar with your operation, you say you have overseas missions as well. Just tell us what you can about what those missions entail. What exactly are your goals overseas in those areas that you mentioned?
Certainly. So, of course, the Air National Guard has a dual mission. We have a state mission, New York State, and also a federal mission. So in a federal status, we deploy all over the globe. We have taken, as I mentioned, troops and equipment to Africa. We've certainly gone downrange to Afghanistan and Iraq. We have been to South America. We have been to Australia, Asia. The only place we haven't been yet is Antarctica. However, we are working on that. We do team up with the 109th Airlift Wing over in Schenectady, and we help ferry their equipment and folks to New Zealand. We're hoping to close the gap and it'll take them all the way to Antarctica sometime in the future. But it's a worldwide mission, and as we like to say, we deliver hope. So whether it's in the form of security forces or medical personnel or equipment or water or food, whatever it is, we deliver hope.
Well, you certainly do. In your position, you're overseeing all of those different missions all over the world. And that's an incredible responsibility. You served over in the Middle East, not as part of this unit, right? But as part of another unit?
Or? So I've served 9 years in the Navy, as the proclamation mentioned. And during that time, I was a mission commander on a P-3, which is an anti-submarine reconnaissance aircraft. And during that time, I did carry live weapons and had weapon release authority from the Persian Gulf. And, it was a very interesting time.
Wow. Yeah. You're talking about an incredible responsibility.
See, kids, that's why you work hard in school. Yeah, yeah. Take an honest breath and listen to your parents. Yes.
That's right. Otherwise, you might end up in politics.
Yeah. Yeah. If you don't study, you might get elected.
You might end up here instead of like your mom.
Okay, yeah.
Don't let this happen to you. Well, come on up, Denise, Colonel Donald. We again just thank you very much for your service.
Absolutely.
And God bless you for what you do, what you've done for many years, and what you do for us
today.
Thank
you very much.
Great. Thanks again very much. And it is fitting that we honor you today because I know for a country at large, you know, for many people individually, since this day, 16 years ago, many lives have changed, many lives have been lost, and it is a day of reflection for all of us. Difficult for many people. So God bless you. Thank you. Okay, we only have 2 other resolutions this evening. Oh, we got you. Jeez. just skip right over Jim. Sorry, Jim. Jim, come on up. Come on up, Jim.
Sorry about that.
Jim Mastriani, he's here to give us our Section 8 Housing Annual Report and tell us what the status is of the program and how things are faring. So how you doing, sir?
Good, good. Thanks for having me, as always. I think this is my 11th year doing this. And I think you're pretty familiar with the mechanics of the program. And oftentimes, I think I come up here and I get a little too deep into the technical details. So I kind of want to take a little bigger picture approach. So when people ask me what I do for a living, they say I help 3,000 families get better outcomes in their life. And how do we do that? We do that by providing safe, sanitary, decent housing. Now, we know this anecdotally, we know this from our own life experience, and we know this from the social science literature. It says, if you do not have stable housing in your life, you cannot have a platform for success in your life. You cannot get positive outcomes. You cannot get that degree. You cannot finish high school. You cannot hold a job if you do not have stable housing. But it's very hard to do that. So that is why we have the Housing Choice Voucher Program, and why in 1976 the federal government decided to start the program. Is that across the nation, and here in Clifton Park, there is a tremendous need for a segment of our population, the elderly, the disabled, and low-income families, who have a hard time affording their housing. And so the idea of the Housing Choice Voucher Program was to use a voucher instead of building public housing, congregate housing, but allow people to take that voucher as their ticket and to move into the community and not live in stigmatized housing, but live in within the community where you can be living next door to someone and no one would ever know that you qualify for this program. The other great benefit of the Housing Choice Voucher Program is that it's portable. And Clifton Park is a wonderful community to live in because there's wonderful services here, there's affordable housing, and you have a wonderful school district. And because of that, the Housing Choice Voucher Program has enabled a bunch of families to be able to move out of other communities with school districts that aren't as good as the Clifton Park District and move into here and be able to have their children get a better education. And so this is what, these are the goals, and this is the purpose of the Housing Choice Voucher Program. Now, we've been doing this really since 1981, and we spend a little more than $300,000 a year to do it. And that allows us to help up to 53 families. Now, the bummer is that there is a tremendously long waiting list for this program. And so right now there are 238 applicants waiting on our list. And we can only help 50 at one, you know, a little more than 50 at a time. And the only way that we can put a new person on is through attrition. And we know that on average in this program, participants access the program for about 10 years. So we have 4, maybe 5 slots open. And so right now, it's a 5-year wait if you apply to this program to be able to get that. And unfortunately, this program has had level or decreased funding for quite some time at the federal level. It's just the way the priorities are set up in the federal government right now. And I don't expect there to be any new funding anytime soon. We don't, you know, who knows what's going on in Washington these days, but certainly I would expect level or decreased funding. I think if we just, you know, there's a bunch of statistics here. I'm not going to go and pull, you know, I'm not going to go any deeper into them. Just, I think one thing that's interesting to note is that the gross monthly income of somebody who's participating in the program is just under $1,200, and then the average subsidy is $500 a month. The fair market rent for the area, which is a number that HUD publishes, which is what we use to build our subsidy on, for a two-bedroom is $1,000 a month. And that's for a modest apartment that's at 30% of the median rent in the area. And then if you look to the back page here, this is just a couple of spreadsheets that just show what we were provided, what we spent, and what the variance is. As of right now, we've been provided $199,000. We've spent $189,000 of that. So we've utilized 95% of the funding. And that's about where we want to be. We usually like to spend a little bit more than that. But to be honest, we've been a little conservative because we don't have a lot of reserves. Because since 2008, HUD has been asking us to spend into the reserves. And so you can see that last year, we wound up with a really decent reserve. If you look way at the bottom of the page, the total reserve was $34,000. And now we're down to about 18, the combination of the HUD help app reserves and the PHA app reserves. So, you know, when you have less than 1 month of funding in the bank, that makes me a little nervous. But we're in a stable position, and if we were starting to get into any type of difficulty, HUD monitors this on a monthly basis, and you know, we submit electronic data every month, and so they have a system to help us prevent shortfall, is what it's called. But that's the big picture overview. I also included another sheet. This is our frequently asked questions for new mayors, supervisors, and board members. And I thought this would be good to have. It's always good to put on your nightstand when that couple of nights you can't fall asleep. That's
what we'd like. So I don't have last year's report in front of me, Jim, but the self-sufficiency,
sure.
Five participants,
yep,
is that on par with last year?
Yep, that's what we target, and we're able to keep five in there. So the Family Self-Sufficiency Program is that adjunct program that we run that works one-on-one with participants to help them move out of subsidized life and into self-sufficiency. The good news is that there are three folks earning escrow accounts, and what that means is that since they started the FSS program to today, they have increased their earned income by getting a better job, by getting a raise, by acquiring better skills. And when they increase their earned income, their subsidy decreases. And so that difference is put into an escrow account. And if they successfully graduate from the program, then they're able to access that money. So that's money that would have been spent anyway had they not gone through the FSS program. And so what it does is it helps people move out of the goal is to move off of camp. And then, and oftentimes, people will then get off of the housing perspective.
Now you said here it's got portability move out,
yep.
It's blank, portability move in 26. So
yes.
Does that go back to what you're saying where people move in but they don't move out?
Yeah, so and actually that's my mistake. There are two numbers on this report that aren't automatically generated, the port move out and port move in. And obviously I forgot to type in, but I happen to know that number's one because I looked it up and so
one person moved
one's
out.
Moved out. They moved far away.
Oh.
They moved, I didn't call it far away. And then the port move-ins, I looked at that. Mostly people are coming from another city in Saratoga County.
Mm.
That isn't Saratoga Springs.
Yeah.
And then you've got a bunch of folks coming from Albany, a bunch of folks coming from the same city.
Mm.
And then a couple of randoms, like New Jersey.
Mm.
And that's that portability component that allows people. Why do people move? People move for economic opportunity, for educational opportunity, or for family reasons.
Okay.
Yeah. That's pretty much it.
Yeah.
And so that's, I would imagine, anecdotally we know that folks who are moving into Clifton Park, it's because of the schools, and it's because there are a large number of service-oriented jobs for
yeah.
participants.
Yeah. Any other questions for Jim at this time? Okay. Well, great, Jim. That's a very good overview. I appreciate you being here.
My
and,
pleasure.
Doing this report once a year to keep us on track with how the program's going. It is an important program and one that we want to continue to work closely with you to ensure it's working well.
Well, very good. Well, I like to close out with we've been working together since 1981, and I think that's just an amazing
yeah.
thing that these two organizations can work for almost 40 years together. And it's insane. It's great. And so
yeah.
I really appreciate all the great work that you do with us to help us be able to do the work for you.
Great. Thanks, Jim.
Great. Thanks,
appreciate
everybody.
It. Yep. All right. We only have two resolutions in addition to the one for Colonel Dowd. So Pat, if you could read through those, and we'll consider each one individually.
A resolution awarding a contract to Bellamy Construction for Berkshire Drive West Drainage Improvement Project. Whereas it has been recommended that a collapsed storm sewer on Berkshire Drive West be replaced, and whereas on September 6, 2017, bids were received for the completion of the drainage project per specifications proposed by McDonald's Engineering, and whereas McDonald's Engineering has recommended that the bid of Bellamy Construction for Directional Drilling be accepted as the lowest, most responsible bidder in an amount of $78,800, and whereas there are sufficient funds authorized by Resolution Number 82 of 2016 for the reconstruction and improvement of storm drainage facilities, now therefore be resolved that the contract for the Berkshire Drive West Drainage Improvement be awarded to Bellamy Construction in an amount not to exceed $78,800, and be further resolved that authorization is hereby granted to the Comptroller to allocate $78,800 from the line that's listed to pay for said repair. A resolution authorizing the supervisor to sign a deed of easement to Argella, Tardelli, and Wallace Pete for the installation of a sewer lateral at 432 Bishop Ferry Drive, Clifton Park. Whereas Argella, Tardelli, and Wallace Pete at 432 Bishop Ferry Drive, Clifton Park seek to connect to public sewer available through the Saratoga County Sewer District facilities. And whereas accessing the sewer facilities requires that the homeowner construct a lateral sewer line beneath town-owned open space land utilizing an existing utility easement reserved to the county of Saratoga for sewer purposes, and whereas the homeowners have applied to the town for an easement to construct the lateral sewer line necessary for connection to the public sewer facilities available in their neighborhood, and whereas the town board supports the expansion of public sewers where feasible, now therefore be resolved that the grant of an easement for utility purposes is a type 2 action pursuant to State Environmental Quality Review Act, and no further review is necessary, and be further resolved that the supervisor is authorized to sign the attached deed of easements to Arbella Cardelli and Wallace Pete at 432 Bishop Ferry Drive, Clifton Park, to enable the construction of a lateral sewer line as shown, contingent upon approval by the town attorney as to form.
Okay. Any questions, Pam? Any questions? Okay, Pam, can you read the headings, please?
So this would be Resolution Number 227 of 2017, a resolution awarding a contract to Bellamy Construction for Berkshire Drive West Drainage Improvement Project.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Romano, second by Ms. Wallowitz. We discussed this at a board meeting in August as the process progressed. And then at the very end of the month, we had the bid opening. So where are we at now, Mr. Bowles, with the timing of the project?
The timing of the project, we're still pushing to have a completion date of October 24th. We're falling within that right now. Passing this resolution today is keeping us on track for that date. Mm. I've contacted all the families involved in the project, and now we've gotten to the point of where, you know, they can just pick up the phone and call me and see what's going on. I send them emails quite constantly, and they're very confident in the process. Mm. We took the boring route again because it's less invasive for the residents in the neighborhood, I think that's the second most important thing. Mm. Most important thing is making sure we have a stormwater system that works. So I think this is a win-win on all counts.
Just a quick recap. I mean, this was found due to a couple of sinkholes that occurred, and then when you took a look inside, saw that the pipe was compromised, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
In short. Yes, the pipe was in trouble. So this is going to fix that.
And if it wasn't fixed, the sinkholes would get bigger, and
which they are.
And it could affect the area properties. Is that correct?
That is correct. We are, but we're making sure that they're staying safe. We keep an eye on it, and I'm hoping that by October 24th, we won't have to worry about it for 50 more years.
That's why I told the folks in Clifton Knolls. I said the good news is we're gonna have to do this for another 60 years
right.
for that sewer project. Yeah. Yeah, you're right. The area residents are very pleased with the boring route, and the fact that it was only $3,000 more was very good.
Right.
Bellamy's a good contractor, right?
We've worked with them in the past. The sewer department's worked with them in the past. They do very good work.
So I think well done. It's a good process, and we're just gonna get the final piece in place. But like you said, it's a good contractor, and they'll do a good job, I'm sure.
All right. One final point, just for the board. Is that we will be sending out a letter Wednesday to residents near the project so they know what's going on and a location that they can go to read more about what's going on in the project so that we're keeping not only the people involved, directly involved, but the neighborhood as well involved.
Yeah, absolutely. And they'll be able to go, that'll be available on the website.
Right? Yeah, I'll work with Matt and we'll get something up on the website that we can update regularly so people know what's happening.
Yeah, good idea. Very good idea. Okay, any questions for Dan? Okay, Pat?
Councilor Whelan?
Yes.
Councilor Standart?
Yes.
Councilor Romano?
Yes.
Councilor Walwood?
Yes.
Supervisor Barrett?
Yes.
Resolution number 228, 2017, resolution authorizing the supervisor to sign a deed of easement to Arvella Tardelli and Wallace Peet for the installation of a sewer lateral at 432 Fisher Ferry Drive, Clifton Park.
So moved.
Second. Moved by Mrs. Standart, second by Mr. Whelan. This is self-explanatory. And does allow for additional sewer services. The town will not be expending any money to make this connection. It'll be the responsibility of the private landowner. But all in all, I think this is a good resolution to this issue. Any questions? Okay.
Councilor Whelan?
Yes.
Councilor Standart?
Yes.
Councilor Romano?
Yes.
Councilor
Walwood?
Yes.
Yes, any other business to come before the board this evening? Okay, seeing none. Go to public privilege. Pam, did you kids?
Yeah.
Oh, he's ready to go.
Yes, that's for kid Nelson.
He's ready to go.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Councilor Whelan?
Yes.
Councilor Standart?
Yes.
Councilor Romano?
Yes.
Councilor Wallace? Supervisor Barrett?
Yes, thank you.